A renegade lawyer is an unlikely accomplice for Angel in an hour. First, Penn and Teller end their magic and mystery tour in China.
We're Penn and Teller. Our new friends have been kind enough to give us this apple. Stuck into the apple, our 100 size number 6 embroidery needle.
That's me, Penn Jillette, and that's my partner Teller, performing on a street in the middle of winter, in the middle of nowhere, which is in the middle of China. Yep, we went to China, saw a lot of magic, and convinced a bunch of village kids that Penn and Teller rule.
Penn and Teller rule. Come on.
It's Penn and Teller. They're on the road together, but their magic carpet's just a dirty rug. So long, Las Vegas. They'll go someplace contagious and get infected by the magic bug. Around the world, down exotic streets, to gaze upon amazing and disgusting feats. Adventure calls. Have you got the cups and balls to stomach blood and guts and gore and more? Come join them as they travel and the mysteries unravel on the Magic and Mystery Tour.
Like most pesky foreigners, we started our journey at a Great Wall. Well, the Great Wall of China. They built this wall to keep marauding invaders out, but it also seems to have done a fine job insulating Chinese culture from foreign influences.
If you ask us, or any magician in the West, who their favorite magician is, you don't know what we might answer. We might say Amazing Randy, who's Canadian. We might say Siegfried and Roy, who are German. But it would be a specific person. Whereas everyone we ask in China, who's your favorite magician, they don't say an individual, they say Chinese magic. The ancient Chinese magic. All of China is magic. But they have a bigger wall than us, by a lot. Around my house, I got like a little fence, you know, it's...
If you ever think of Chinese performers at all, you think plate spinners, contortionists, and acrobats. But what most people don't know is that Chinese magic is part of that same 2,000-year-old tradition. There are tricks being performed today that have been around for centuries. And we're here to find out how modern Chinese magicians are keeping this ancient art form alive. In Beijing, we found performers who've made it their life's work to perfect a single traditional Chinese trick. The bowl trick is a hallmark Chinese trick that dates back over 1,000 years. Mr. Fang has been perfecting this trick for only 20. These 20 years have bought him the ability to produce 18 bowls of water on an empty stage. Here's a man whose entire act is just one trick, but it's a good trick.
It's amazing that you can do a trick that is good, even though everybody in the audience knows that the bowls are hidden kind of under this tent you're wearing, but it's still amazing enough that it really worked. It's a lot of bowls.
Backstage now.
Backstage is the same the world over. Watch your head here. Great. Wonderful. Wonderful.
By the way, this is Wendy, our translator.
It was a wonderful bowl act. So clean. It's just seamless.
And I think it's important to point out that you fooled us.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you one thing. We're not playing with kids back here. We're not playing with kids. Listen to that. This is heavy. You hide this on your body, compadre.
It's just amazing. 都是真的.
Fang told us he learned this trick from his master, who in turn learned it from his master.
Altogether in his robe, it was looking about 80 pounds.
This trick will be passed down only through apprenticeship, and so far he hasn't found a suitable candidate, someone who can be trusted with the secret and who's strong enough to carry 18 glass bowls full of water.
Well, that final forward roll with the bowl production is just breathtaking. And who are your favorite Western magicians?
西方我作为那个大卫比较知道，因为知道他看过他的录像，也是跟那刚才那个罗先生说的一样，我们在中国有好多美国的魔术师，著名的魔术录像，我们都看。
I've picked up a little Chinese. David.
His Chinese name.
That's our Chinese name. Our Chinese name is David Copperfield. Is the name that we use over here. If you're going to go see Penn and Teller, it'd be David Copperfield. But over in the States, we work under the name of Penn and Teller. Who else did he mention?
That's the only name he mentioned.
Of course, that would be the only two names he mentioned, with David Copperfield, which is Penn and Teller in Chinese.
Beijing once had a tradition of street magic, and many tricks, like the bowl trick, originated on the streets. But Mao's cultural revolution took magic off the streets. The magicians were too capitalist, too entrepreneurial.
So, if we're gonna find magic in China, we're not gonna find it on the streets, we're not gonna find it in Tiananmen Square, we're gonna have to go elsewhere.
What if we can get this guy back in Vegas? We should tour the US like this. We headed to Beijing Tea House, a local hangout that showcases traditional Chinese performance. Tea houses are like Starbucks, except they don't have coffee. They have tea. That's why they're called tea houses. And here, your pets can enjoy the atmosphere, too.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man. That's not just a cricket. That's a cricket. That's a big-ass grasshopper.
Pet crickets are kept in cases with metal springs to amplify their chirp.
Oh, how cool. It's just so beautiful.
I was happy with the insect, but Teller wanted to see the world's best quick change artist. This trick came out of the Sichuan opera over 100 years ago, where it was used to tell the story of a capricious king who changed his face on the battlefield. It started out with two masks, but Mr. Wan Zhu had ambitions. He's up to 10. His whole life is one trick, and it's perfect. And don't waste your time trying to bust this guy by taping the show and slowing it down. We tried, but he's just too darn good. Juan makes the masks himself to ensure that the secret technique stays secret.
I don't know if that comes across on TV at all, because the instantaneous changes, there's just like that. It's probably one of the most amazing magic things I've ever seen, and all homemade by an absolute genius. And now why don't you just run along, go peddle your papers. Just run along, go there.
The nice thing about China is that every tea house still has a smoking section. You don't get that at Starbucks.
Oh. How much translate? How about translate this? How about goddamn that burned my mouth?
I said, we set this up beforehand. I'm gonna put the fire in my mouth and there'll be a fire, and then you come in quickly and light the cigarette. Quickly, the word was said quickly, the adverb was translated, quickly you come in. And then, when he got time to do it, the fire is there, it's burning out of my mouth, and what does he do? He takes time before he comes in and stops me from burning. Or he could have been just trying to hurt me.
One more time, we'll do it.
Oh,
Now all I need is a cricket. I got my cricket case. He says it will keep him alive, but I won't know how good he'll sound. But I think he'll sound fine. I'll go to a pet store in Vegas and I'll buy myself some crickets.
Those are like cocoons or something. These are all insects.
They say you haven't truly experienced China till you sample the local cuisine.
Crabs, grasshoppers, ectoskeleton feast.
I'd rather eat fire.
This is stuff that we brought from home and from another foreign country, Canada. And I got chicken chop suey and chicken fried rice from Canada to eat over here. Sparrows on a stick.
Spaghetti sauce, lots of tuna, lots of chicken.
These are scorpions. Back in the States, eating these would be an act, would be entertainment. If we ate these, people would pay us money.
Here I have. Was this restaurant feature?
Loosely translated, it says, fragrant and tasty dog casserole.
Fortunately, Wendy is here to help us understand the nuances of this strange and exotic culture.
What could be loose about translating the word dog?
No, I meant the fragrant and tasty part.
Oh, fragrant and tasty, okay. But dog is actually literal.
Right? Yeah, dog is dog.
It's only, the only thing you're kind of taking poetic license with is fragrant. Could also be smelly and tasty dog casserole.
I don't know about Teller, but my Chinese food is coming out of a can. There's something suspect about magicians. That's international and timeless. In fact, over 600 years ago, Marco Polo, in his travels to China, had this to say about magicians. Magicians are foul and filthy. They have no self-respect and do not care about anyone. Their faces are always dirty and they neither wash nor comb their hair. If a man is justly condemned to death by the authorities, these men cook and eat the body. They do not, however, eat anyone who has died a natural death. We'll show Marco Polo.
How?
Chinese magicians in the 50s and 60s were considered deceitful and therefore anti-communist. The state burned and destroyed magic props. Could have been the end of Chinese magic, but we magicians are a tenacious lot.
I suppose now that our hair's clean, we have to stop eating human flesh, right? Look at that. Those are two very clean magicians.
That's right.
With our big city Beijing hairdos, we headed for Wu Chao County, 300 miles south of Beijing. Why a slow train to Wu Chao? What were we thinking? Wu Chao is considered the birthplace of magic and the cradle of acrobatics in China.
You know, we interviewed a lot of these magicians, and we asked them the question you'd ask any American magician, any American performer, any American, which is, how did you learn this? And the answer we always got was they learned it from the great master, or their master, who then had a great master, and it goes way back. And we asked them what kind of additions they made, what kind of little wrinkles they put in, and they all would deny any sort of originality. They all would say that every word they said, all the patter, everything absolutely went back to ancient history. They were very, very proud of that. And it was really interesting how that's exactly the opposite of us. I mean, you interview us, we say that we invented everything. Cards were our idea, handcuffs, our idea, straitjackets, our idea, coins, our idea. You know, for coin magic, it ended up having a use for trade. And so, here we go to Wu Chao to see the cradle of acrobatics, magic, and juggling. But the cradle of acrobatics, magic, and juggling from the U.S. sitting right here in this berth.
Penn and Teller rule.
Penn and Teller rule. Hey, 说不好。
Wu Chao Acrobatics School opened in 1985. Kids as young as 6 live and train here for up to 6 years. In China, you don't practice alone in your backyard. Here, even if you want to run away and join the circus, you still have to go to school.
This is the finest acrobatic school in all of China, which probably means certainly one of the best in the world. If you're a kid and you want to learn acrobatics, oh, good one. You come here to Wu Chow and you study and you practice all day until you're really good. Now we've got tumbling, we've got plate spinning, and we've got this weird jug on the head thing going on. But we also found out there's a classroom here that teaches students magic.
Before going to the classroom, we wanted to play a little more. The students embrace their fate with discipline and respect. Even our visit didn't faze them.
Let's see what we have here. My dad hated three things in the world, accordions, fuzzy caterpillars, and plate spinning. This little girl here has been doing this cool stuff. She has this cut on her nose from having that bottle on there for so long.
Oh yeah!
Come on. Look at the top of this kid's head. He's practiced so much, he has actual jug burn on his head from catching it there. Now there's some commitment for you.
The Chinese government has always supported acrobatics. Mao was a big fan. But magic has only recently come back into favor, this time with state support. Instead of tricks being passed down from a master to a single student, at Wu Chow Acrobatic School, they started a class, and they hired a master to be the teacher. But there's not much traditional magic in this state-run school. These future magicians of China are learning very basic stuff, linking rings, cups and balls, some card sleights, and some prop tricks. The kids apply themselves to this one-year magic program in the same way they'd apply themselves to, say, something useful like algebra.
You're probably finding the classroom magic stuff to be completely unbelievable. The idea to a Westerner that you would learn to do something artistic identical. He was taking a routine that he himself had done and just teaching it by rote to these classrooms of people. It looked like they set it up because it was just so perfect in the idea of how communism would work. Oh, we've got a funny routine and everybody's going to learn it. They welcomed us into the classroom, let us sit in the back and sit in on the linking ring session, but we were not allowed to touch the rings. When Teller picked them up, he was reprimanded. They were very upset we might find out the secret.
And we thought we'd do a little bit of magic. I guess you're familiar with a standard deck of cards. I'm just going to riffle down the deck. And why don't you just say stop or ting? Is it what? Ting?
Ting.
Just say ting as I riffle down.
And we did our little three of clubs trick. It seemed to play fine, although they wouldn't laugh until the teacher laughed. And the idea there was something original in that you know, Teller was wearing sunglasses, you know, this kind of thing, and that we had come up with that meant nothing.
Digimon?
No.
Digimon?
No.
For the love of Pete, Digimon!
No.
You see, could you help me here? With the sunglasses, maybe you have to use your and Digimon? Yeah, sure it is. Yes, he's so good. He's so much better than I could ever be.
So where can a graduate of China's top acrobatic school hope to find work? Though they may have dreams of touring the world, they're more likely to find themselves about a mile down the road from the school. Built in 93, Acrobatic World is run by the state in association with a Hong Kong tourist company. It showcases the region's talents and was supposed to bring in Chinese tourists. The place is deserted. Acres of massive buildings and open-air performance spaces. If you want to beat the crowds, come at, well, any time.
The responsibility of being in a small audience is overwhelming. We had to keep applauding and applauding and applauding, but it's okay because it kept us warm, because these people were performing in a really cold place for no one, for just for us. So we tried to show our enthusiasm.
Well, the show must go on. Without an audience, even during these winter months when it's around 15 below.
It's well below freezing out here. Never mind the metal rod, it's well below freezing, and he's not wearing a shirt. Now watch this.
He really wants to make sure we know it's real wire.
I have on three pairs of socks with chemical warmers. I have silk long underwear, thermal long underwear, suit pants. I have a silk top. I have a thermal top. I have a shirt. I have a tie. I have a vest. I have a thermal scarf. I have a down jacket. We have these stupid hats on, and I have mittens that have in them chemical things. I'm still freezing, and my nose is running, and that nut is out here with no shirt on, wrapping metal around his neck. It's a great country full of great magic. I'm still freezing.
But if performing tricks in the freezing cold seems crazy, the best is yet to come. Acrobatic World's colossal deserted shrine to magic. Room after room, act after act, performing standard sleight of hand for no one but us and our crew. Would they have still performed if we weren't there? There's no way of knowing. On automatic pilot, performers appear on stage, do their show, and quietly disappear.
This is the strangest place we've ever been. It has been below freezing, absolutely below freezing. Every second we've been inside, it's been below freezing. There are performers doing palming, they're doing back palming, they're doing all these moves very well, beautifully done. These are really wonderful professional performers working under conditions that I wouldn't say are inhuman, I wouldn't say unimaginable, I would just say they're working under conditions that have no reason to exist. This is some sort of nutty dream of somebody or some party or some government where they would build this huge magic world, and it's very, very clear. If you build it and don't hate it, no one will come. I wish every one of you could come here and be in this walk-in freezer with professional magicians. I guess this is where magicians are paying for all the sins of torturing women and doves for years and years and years. You know, Mr. Zhang, who's the magic teacher at the magic school we went to, was going to give us a little private lesson of some coin tricks. So we got in the van this morning. It was a beautiful wintry day. We were riding along in the van singing, and this is literally true, singing Walking in a Winter Wonderland. Well, at least I was, no one was joining in, but that's not important. And as the snow blanketed all the fields around us, it also blanketed the highway. So as we were turning, a large hay truck, we got hit by a truck.
This is where we got hit by a truck.
That's why we're not in a nice little village freezing in a hut, because we got hit by a truck.
The truck slid along here, spun us in a 360.
It was a hay truck.
His American head went right through this whole back window here.
That's the safety glass. And my left shoulder went through the side window.
My shoulder went through here.
And Teller was whacked around too. Not hurt bad, not that you care, just watching TV, but not hurt badly. So what we did, because our van was ruined by getting hit by a hay truck.
That was our accident.
Was we sent a car for Mr. Zhang and brought him here to a warm hotel. Not a hardship for any of us, but doesn't have that beautiful rustic look that you wanted. And we made him bring his table because we wanted a little bit of that real China look. So bring your table. And so that's why you're seeing Mr. Zhang outside of his, shall we say, natural habitat. We were hit by a truck. I still have little pieces of safety glass in my hair.
The magic teacher came to show us the Han Ping Chen move, a Chinese coin trick. Watch this. He holds one coin in one hand and two coins in the other. When he places his hand under the table, look at that. The single coin has penetrated the wood.
Very nice, wonderful.
Teller wanted to learn this move from an authentic Chinese master. Zhang was happy to oblige, he claimed. But Teller knew enough about the trick to know he was scamming us.
Also looked a little fishy there. I wasn't feeling good. Like I said, it looked perfect the way you put two under there and one over there.
But we played along.
So I was hit by a truck today. What do I know? There you go. You got the two there. You got the one over there. Two go under the table. Oh,
Mr. Zhang was born into a circus family and moved from acrobatics to magic as a teen.
He learned it from his father, and his father learned it from his father.
Well, I'll be hornswoggled. There it is right there.
Then Teller gave the teacher a magic trick from the States and did show him, but not you, how it worked. He seemed to like it.
Remember the Chinese teacher? He wouldn't let us touch the linking rings.
He was reprimanded.
Because this was an ancient secret that you could never find anywhere. We couldn't touch the linking rings. Let me show you something.
How much are these?
Well, we were going to bargain now.
Well, yeah, sure.
Here we go. I haven't spent a dime. And here's all the information on how to do that whole thing. If you want to learn the linking rings, we don't want to give away secrets, but all you got to do is freeze frame this, learn Chinese, and then you can do, actually it's in English too, isn't it?
Wow.
How much are they?
15 each, so she said 30 for the two.
Well, that's a good deal. And you know, we were very careful not to tell our crew how this was done. So there you go. You can figure it out. And there's for the director. And here you go, Wendy.
Thank you.
So they've been watching all this stuff and not knowing how it was done. Have you seen the linking rings?
No, I speak English.
Ah, French. Now you can learn the linking rings. Here you go. We're going to teach the ancient secret of the Chinese linking rings. Now we're spreading it all over France. Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Thank you, boss.
Yes. Thank you, Shane. Yes.
32-year-old Zhengju Chong's parents put her in acrobatic school at 9 years old. She now works with the Beijing acrobatic troupe. Chong claims she is the only Chinese woman to juggle on horseback and that this was her own innovation. For the first time during our visit, we found someone who was open to improvising.
We jugglers all have long arms.
That's it. That'll work out.
Right.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and the foot went up. I just spit all over myself. You want to light them up?
So working with the juggler was terrific because I've been juggling since I was 12. I started out as a professional juggler. First few shows I did juggling right out of high school, I didn't talk at all. I was just a straight or a jumpsuit, and all we ever said on stage was hop, and then did okay. Really hard stuff. So it was wonderful to be able to interact, probably in all of these tricks. It's the only time that I really had communication that wasn't through a translator or someone speaking a second language.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Come on, Mama, walk it home, baby. Ho! Don't worry about him. In the USA, human life is cheap. Four, five, six, seven, eight. No one noticed. 9, 10.
After she made it clear through a translator that everything she was doing with me, she could also do on horseback, I had to pull out this stupid, almost frat boy stunt of breaking liquor bottles and juggling them, which is a stupid trick to do. You can get cut to ribbons. But you know, when you're trying to impress a Chinese woman, you gotta pull out the big guns.
And so you have no idea how they're gonna turn or how they're gonna end up. It feels like it's still breaking a little bit. No cuts.
Penn,
we got lucky.
And Taylor.
Yay! Perfect.
Well, Penn and Taylor.
Penn and Taylor.
Go to the bus.
Go to the bus.
Good thing. So long. We'll go to the bus.
再见.
We're now on our way to Wangking, a farming village about 370 miles south of Beijing. Aside from its unfortunate name, we heard that we'd find something unique in this community. This seems like an unlikely place to find magic, but for centuries, farmers and their families have been moonlighting as magicians in the winter months to supplement their farming income. Why subsistence farmers would want to become subsistence magicians is anyone's guess. The Wangkingers welcomed us warmly.
This is the exact middle of nowhere.
It was hard to imagine this as a place that just might have more performers per capita than Vegas.
Keep your head down here.
When they're not working the land, they're working the room.
Hey, it is an egg bag. Here we are in yet another house. It's just that everybody in this neighborhood does magic. I mean, these people have, you know, two-room houses, and they're mostly full of magic props. Very nice. I mean, this guy's like, you know, four houses over. This is another neighbor. Now, what town in North America can you just go to a random neighbor's house and have him swallow a sword? Good posture. Good posture for a sword swallower there. Yeah.
Oh, look at that. You got some boss kicks there, don't you? Those are boss kicks.
I like those shoes.
Our final destination was the Zhang household, a family who've been magicians for at least five generations.
So do the children do magic?
The 80-year-old head of the family has four sons and lots more relatives living in the village, and they all do magic.
So you're going to the market to perform today?
We're all prepared.
Great. Do you know the The needle trick? You know that trick? My partner Teller does that trick. I think he does it pretty well. Would you like him to do it in your show today?
Both
of you are magicians as well?
Yeah, that's what we do.
He said, yes, we're from very far away, but we have something in common that's very important.
Half a world away.
So we all set off to market to kick off the first Vegas Wang King co-production.
And off to market we go. What did he ask you? Oh, sure, go.
Wendy?
Thank you.
So finally, in rural China, we were to experience our first street performance, and Teller got a gig as a guest star. How cool is that?
Comedy magic team to two people in a family of 300 or 400.
The father gave an apple from the family orchard for Teller's trick.
Speak English. If you speak English, there's a magic show going on over there.
The family we saw at the market did a 2.5 hour show in the freezing cold, and the audience of course wanted to crowd in just for warmth purposes, but they first sprinkled this little line along to keep people behind the line, and then as the show goes on, people cross the line, they go by with a stick and kind of whacking them with a stick to keep them back, and then as it goes on a little longer, they come by with a machete. And the final thing near the end to keep them back is the father spit in a tray, and they kind of flung it at the audience to keep them back. We were well back. We had respect for the spit. Well, really, what you're seeing on the streets of China is they've got about 7.5 minutes of material crammed into 2.5 hours. They really do get every little ounce of entertainment they can possibly get out of every little trick.
The first act on the bill was an uncle and a snake. Then the rest of the relatives. The first son, the second son, a cousin, a second cousin once removed, a whole genealogical tree of magicians. This audience would be the envy of acrobatic world. Actually, any audience would be the envy of acrobatic world.
And the father, to watch it work, is great. He just has this lovable quality that you're happy to be in his presence, and there's a great deal of charm. He takes a raid can or something with some sort of product and makes this little prop out of it. And he's got his little gourd with a little thing that pops out, and the awl, he makes a little awl that gave away the trick. But he got the awl that he pokes into his eye for real.
Huh? 没事儿，有事儿，哎呀。
and all of that. And all the stuff is kind of homemade. So it's not only a magic show, it's also kind of a crafts demonstration. I guess in the U.S. you'd call it performance art and get a big grant for it.
Song cut! Kill! Yeah!
We finally get to see the kuma tube, which is a real ancient Chinese trick, and it was built by the guy himself. And we got to see him pull, I think, everything he owned. But that's a trick that's done all over the world. It started in China. We got to see where it started. And we also, it seemed like we get to see when it started and watched it right up to the present day. I think we went through the Ming Dynasty, as a matter of fact, during that trick. You'll see it a shorter version, but we were out there for, I think it ran about a week. Actually, he originally used to do it with the Grateful Dead backing him up. But with Jerry Garcia dead, he has to do it out in the freezing cold alone. Teller picked this volunteer because of the earmuffs.
Oh,
The response to Teller's performance proved to us that magic crosses all cultures, and we were touched by the family who welcomed us into their troupe. Before leaving, the father invited us back to his home. He had something for Teller.
Watch your head.
Yes, I made it myself.
Oh, you did?
Go to bed.
He wants you to keep this as a gift.
You have such a wonderfully talented family. How many people have you taught, do you figure? How many people? How can he possibly be answering before it gets translated?
您招过了几个?
多吧也不很多,有个...
There's five in the immediate family and seven or eight other students.
Wow. Thank you. It was a wonderful show. Thanks. Thank you so much. And we'd like to give you this. It says...
And that's how we came to convince a Chinese village in the middle of nowhere that Penn and Teller rule. They love Teller's needle trick. They think I'm a friendly giant. And we convinced the old father to head up a branch of our fan club. You know, there's a lot of people here in China.
Penn and Teller.
Penn and Teller.
Oh, boy. 1.3 billion Penn and Teller fans on their way. We love Penn and Teller. We love Penn and Teller. We love Penn and Teller. Rule!
So, there you have it. Ancient Chinese culture and traditional Chinese magic, brought to you by two guys from Vegas.
Thanks. In the States, whenever we start a sporting event, we start by the whole audience rising and singing the national anthem. We found out that in China, they end every show at the tea house by performing in unison the national magic trick. That's how important magic is to this culture. And we were very honored, but they've asked us at the end of this tea house performance to lead the national magic trick. So, if you'd all rise, please. Wow. Look, my hand is empty. Look, a little red hanky. Watch closely. Not closely enough, it's gone. But a little whiffle dust and it's back. Thank you. Look. Not closely enough, it's gone. But a little whiffle does, and it's back. Thank you. Shake it.
Thank you.